الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى صراط المستقيم صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على نهجه واقتفى أثره ليوم الدين أما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. After praising Allah Jalla fi Ulaha and sending salutations upon our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, we proceed. And alhamdulillah, Allah Azza wa Jalla, that He's gathered us here this evening once again. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make this a blessed gathering. And we ask Allah Jalla fi Ulaha to make us from those who have forgiven this gathering. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, just like He gathered us here this evening, that He gathers us in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la, innahu jawadun kareem. Ayyuha al-ikhwatu al-akhawat, we are on a journey to the hereafter. We are on a journey to the world of the unseen, which Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has described to us in the Quran. Every single one of us is on that journey. In our last session last week, we spoke about the reality that no one denies, which is the reality of death. That every single one of us is going to die. He is going to meet his Lord Jalla wa Ala, and it's a matter of what he has prepared for that next life. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he lived in Medina for 10 years, and he was calling to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala for 23 years, 13 years in Mecca, 10 years in Medina. And he called the people to guidance, to goodness, to that which will protect them in this world and the hereafter, grant them success in this world and the hereafter. And he sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he left behind a great message, the Quran, which Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed to him so that we live by and we are guided by it. Our Messenger alayhi salatu salam, ar-Rahmatul Muhda alayhi salatu salam, who Allah Azza wa Jalla described in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you, O Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, except as a mercy to mankind. And he Jalla wa Ala, he says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَظًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَانْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. It's only with the mercy of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that you are merciful towards them, lenient towards them, Muhammad alayhi salatu, gentle. And if you are harsh and rude, they will disperse from you. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. And بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Merciful, compassionate to the believers. That's the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. There is no khair, goodness, except that he told us about it. And there's no evil except that he warned us from it. And the greatest of that goodness that he told us about, it is the goodness that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has prepared for us hereafter. The reward of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And the evil that He warned us from the greatest, it is the punishment of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, and everything that leads to the punishment of Allah Jalla fi'ula. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam told us in detail, in the hadith of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he said that when the believer is dying, the angels are going to approach him in a beautiful manner. They look beautiful. And they're going to say to the soul of the believer, exit, O pure soul, to your Lord who is pleased with you, and you shall be pleased. And the soul of the believer will come out in an easy manner. In the other hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, it is like when an individual sweats. It will be like that. He will not fail, he will not feel much pain and agony. Is that all the believers? No. Some of the believers will feel the pain and sakarat of maut. And that does not mean that they are bad. It doesn't mean that's an evil end either. Because when you face that pain of death, it is takfir lidhunub wa rif'a lidarajat. It is to expiate your sins and to elevate your status in the hereafter. Because the best of creation, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he faced that pain and agony of death, alayhi salatu wasalam, which we're going to come to. So he alayhi salatu wasalam, he said that soul will be taken out, and when it's taken out, it is going to be raised to the heavens, and it's going to smell like misk, and it's going to be called by the best names that it had in this dunya. And then the soul will be sent back to the earth, back to the slave of Allah Azza wa Jalla's body, whilst he's in his grave. And he will be sat up, and he will be visited by two angels that look black and blue, the hadith says. Huge angels who are terrifying. And they approach this individual and they ask him three questions. Man Rabbuk, who is your Lord? Man Deenuk, what is your religion? Man Ar-Rajul Alladhi Bu'itha Ilaykum, and who is the man who was sent to you? Or what do you say about the man who was sent to you? That believer will respond, Rabbi Allah, Deeni al-Islam. And that man who was sent to me, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And then the caller will call out from the heavens, saying, my slave has uttered the truth. And then his grave will be made vast, as far as his eyes can see. And a window will be opened for him, showing him his position in Jannah. And he will be approached by an individual who looks extremely beautiful, smells very nice. He asks him, who are you? He says, I am your righteous deeds. I'm going to accompany you until Yawm al-Qiyamah. And as for the disbeliever, the angels that approach him will look terrifying when he's dying. And they're going to say to his soul, oh filthy soul, exit to a Lord who is angry with you, to the punishment of Allah and the anger of Allah. And it will be raised to the heavens. It smells filthy. And it will be called by all the worst names that it had in the dunya. And then it will be sent back to the earth. And the angels will question that individual. The same questions. مَنْ رَبُّكَ You say, لَا أَدْرِي Or another riwayah, لَا أَدْرِي I don't know. He will be asked, what is your religion? I don't know. Who is the man who sent you? I don't know. And then, each time, he will be hit by the angels, the huge hammer that they have. And his grave will become a pit from the pits of the hellfire. And a window will be open for him, showing him his position in the hellfire. And the flames and the heat of the hellfire is coming into his grave. And his grave will become extremely narrow and small. And tight. And he will be approached by an individual who looks ugly and smells awful. And he will say, who are you? He will say, I'm your evil deeds. I'm going to accompany you until Yawm al-Qiyamah. That life, it is known as Hayatul Barzakh, the life of the Barzakh. And that's a different life to the life of the dunya. Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He mentions it in the Quran. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He says, Hatta idha jaa ahadahumul maut, qala rabbi rji'un, la'alli a'malu salihan fima tarak. كلا إنها كلمة هو قائلها ومن ورائهم برزخ إلى يوم يبعثون. Allah says, when the disbelievers die, this ayah is referring to, he will see the angels who approach and take his soul. He will say, قَالَ رَبِّ الْجُعُونَ Take me back to the dunya, لَعَلِّي so that I can do righteous deeds in what I left behind. كَلَّا That will not be the case. If he was taken back, he would do the exact same thing. It's just a statement that he's uttering. And then Allah says, وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثٌ And waiting for them is barzakh. That's life in the barzakh until the day they're resurrected, in the graves. The life in the grave. Barzakh, linguistically in the Arabic language, it means a position or something that's between two stages. Something that's been in between two stages, right? Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, مَرَجَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ يَلْتَقِيَانِ بَيْنَهُمَا بَرْزَخٌ لَا يَبْغِيَانِ Allah talks about the two seas that don't meet. Allah says, between them is barzakhun, right? A stage which splits them apart, these two parts of the sea. That's what it means linguistically. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, He tells us, referring to Fir'aun and the people of Fir'aun, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَحَاقَ بِآلِ فِرْعَوْنَ سُوءَ الْعَذَابِ النَّارُ يُعْرَضُونَ عَلَيْهَا غُدُوًّا وَعَشِيًّا وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةُ أَدْخِلُوا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ أَشَدَّ الْعَذَابِ. Allah says that Fir'aun and his household, those who followed him, they're going to face a terrible punishment, right? And now وَيُعْرَضُونَ عَلَيْهَا, the fire, they're going to be presented to it day and night, right? Where is this? The ulama, they explain this ayah, this is in the grave. This is the punishment that they're going to face in the grave, because after that Allah says وَيَوْمَ تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ, and the day, the hour is established. أَدْخِلُوا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ أَشَدَّ الْعَذَابِ, it will be said to the family of Fir'aun, his people, enter the severest punishment, i.e. the one of the hellfire. Indicating that there's punishment in the grave. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَإِنَّ لِلَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا عَذَابًا دُونَ ذَلِكَ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Verily those who were transgressors, who transgress in this world, right? For them it's عذاباً, a punishment دون ذلك, before the other punishment, i.e. of the hellfire, indicating that the punishment is that punishment of the grave. So Allah Azza wa Jalla refers to the punishment of the grave. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he also mentioned that in numerous ahadith. One day the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he came across two graves. And then he said that these two individuals who are in their graves, they are being punished, and they are not being punished for something great. It's something that they could have avoided. It's something that was avoidable. He said, as for the first, he never used to protect himself from his urine and clean himself from his urine after he urinates. And the other, he used to go around telling tales, taking tales from one person to another to cause enmity between them. It's something that's avoidable, right? It caused them to be punished in the grave. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned other ahadith as well, that he specified that the qabr will be إِمَّا رَوْضَةٌ مِنْ رِيَاضِ الْجَنَّةِ أَوْ حُفْرَةٌ مِنْ حُفَرِ النِّيرَانِ أَوْ حُفْرَةٌ مِنْ حُفَرِ النَّارِ. He said that the grave, it will be either a garden from the gardens of paradise or a pit from the pits of the hellfire. So that stage in the barzakh that every single one of us is going to go through, when he dies, he's already going to know where he's heading towards. He's going to go through sakarat al-maut. He's going to have an idea in those moments what he's going to get in that life and in the life of the akhirah. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he came back from Hajjatul Wada', his farewell sermon and his farewell Hajj. And when he came back, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he came to Medina, he fell ill. And he was ill for a number of months, and his illness kept getting worse and worse and worse. And he alayhi salatu wasalam, as his illness was getting worse, he eventually became bedbound and he could not leave his home, sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And then he commanded that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was going to lead the people in prayer. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is at home. He has an extreme fever. His illness is not getting better. Until the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he one day he felt better and he told the Sahaba radiallahu anhum to escort him to the masjid, and he went to the masjid and he ascended the pulpit and he delivered a sermon to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. He said to them, what do you think of a man who Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has given a choice between this dunya, this worldly life, and that which is with Allah azza wa jalla hereafter? And he chose that which is with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu started to cry. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhu said, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was a'lamuna. And the Prophet alayhi salatu was referring to himself. He was the most knowledgeable amongst Abu Bakr. He knew who the Prophet alayhi salatu was referring to. And that's why he cried, radiyallahu anhu Allah. He realized the Prophet alayhi salatu salam that he's departing his world. So then the Prophet alayhi salatu, after that day, he went back home and he didn't feel any better. He was getting worse and his health was deteriorating even more. And whilst he was in his home, the Sahaba radiyallahu anhu were visiting him, and his uncle Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib radiyallahu anhu arda, he came and visited his nephew, the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. And when he saw him, he left the house and he said to his other relatives, amongst them was Ali ibn Muttalib radiyallahu anhu, he said to him, Wallahi, laqad ra'aytu al-mawta fi ayni. I saw death in his eyes, just like I saw it in the eyes of the children of Abdul Muttalib. And then Sahaba would be coming in and out to the house of the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, until the daughter of the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, Fatima radiyallahu anha, she entered upon her father in the house of Aisha radiyallahu anha, and she said, wa karba, oh the distress, i.e. the distress that her father is going through. And then he said to her alayhi salatu salam, oh Fatima, your father is not going to see any distress after this day. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the pain that he was feeling, it was getting worse and worse and worse, to the extent that he said that I feel the pain that two of you feel, two men amongst you, the pain that they feel, I'm going through that. And then he alayhi salatu wasalam, he was finding it difficult to speak. He gave his life last advices to the ummah. Before that, tell them as-salah, as-salah wa malakat aymanukum, and so on. The prayer, God, your prayers and what your right hand possesses. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, she has the Prophet alayhi salatu salam on her lap. And he alayhi salatu salam, he started muttering under his breath, Bali al-Rafiq al-A'la, Bali al-Rafiq al-A'la, oh, the highest companion. I choose the highest companion. So she said, fa'alimtu annahu yukhayyir. I realized that he's being given a choice between this dunya and the hereafter, and he chose that which is with Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And then he alayhi salatu salam, he started to say, La ilaha illallah, inna lilmawti lasakarat. La ilaha illallah, inna lilmawti lasakarat. La ilaha illallah, inna lilmawti lasakarat. That death, it has pain and agony. And he was repeating that. And he would say, Allahumma ghafirli warhamni alhiqni bil rafiq al-a'la, oh Allah, forgive me and have mercy upon me and let me join the highest companion. And then he alayhi salatu left this world. The day the Prophet alayhi salatu came to Medina was the brightest day in Medina, and the day the Prophet alayhi salatu passed away was the darkest day in Medina. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhu were in disbelief. They couldn't believe what had happened. Aisha radiallahu anha, she reports that Umar radiallahu anhu and Mughir ibn Shu'bah, when they heard the news, they came to the house of Aisha radiallahu anha, and they knocked on the door of Aisha, and she asked, who is it? And he said, it's Umar and Mughira. And then she granted them permission to enter, and she says, I want to go grab my hijab to cover myself up. And then Umar radiallahu anhu and Mughira, they entered, and he looked at the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, and Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, wa ghashiya. He said that the Prophet alayhi salatu is unconscious. Oh, how unconscious he is. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he said that he's unconscious alayhi salatu salam, that he's sleeping. And he didn't want to believe that the Prophet alayhi salam is dead. He said the Prophet alayhi salam has not died, he's unconscious, he's gone to his Lord and he's going to come back. And he went out to say to the people that the Prophet alayhi salam has not passed away. They're munafiqeen, hypocrites, who are saying that the Prophet alayhi salatu salam has passed away. He has not died, he has left, just like Musa alayhi salam went to his Lord and he came back. The Prophet alayhi salam went to his Lord and he's going to come back inshaAllah ta'ala. Until the hypocrites are removed from the earth, the Prophet alayhi salam don't go to die, he kept saying. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu heard the news, and he came to the house of Aisha radiallahu anha, and he entered, and then he saw the Prophet alayhi salam lying there, and he placed his hand over the hand over the body of the Prophet alayhi salam, and he uncovered his face and looked at the face of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he looked at him and said, wa khalila, oh my closest companion. And then he radiyallahu anhu, he cried, and he looked at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, his face, and he kissed him his forehead, and he said, ya Rasulullah, you have tasted death, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is not going to make you experience death twice. And then he kissed the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام on his forehead again, and he looked at him and he said, Ya Rasulallah, طبت حيا وميتا يا رسول الله. You are pure, dead and alive, O Messenger of Allah. And he kissed him again on his forehead, and then he covered his face, and then he رضي الله عنه gathered himself, and he went out, and he saw Umar رضي الله عنه delivering his sermon, shouting at the people, saying what he was saying, and he said to him, sit down. He didn't sit down. He told him, sit down, Ya Umar. He didn't sit down. He told him, be quiet, Ya Umar. He didn't go quiet. He told him, calm down, Ya Umar. He didn't calm down. And he kept carrying on. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu ignored him. And he started to praise Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and send salutation upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then he said, Ayyuhal nas. Ala man kana ya'budu Muhammadan fa inna Muhammadan qad mat. Wa man kana ya'budu Allah fa inna Allah hayyu la yamut. He said, whoever used to worship Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, Muhammad has passed away alayhi salatu wasalam. And whoever used to worship Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, then know that Allah is hayyun la yamut, that Allah azza wa jal is hayy, ever living, la yamut, does not die. And then he recited qawlahu ta'ala, that Allah azza wa jal says, innaka mayyitun wa innahum mayyitun. Verily you shall die, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, and they shall also die. And then he recited the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرَّسُولُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. That Muhammad is nothing but a messenger. And before him have come messengers. If he was to die or to be killed, are you going to turn back on your heels, i.e. leave Islam? And whoever turns back on his heels, he will not harm Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in any way. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will reward those who are grateful. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu, when they heard these ayat, they started repeating the ayat. And Umar radiallahu anhu calmed down and he started repeating the ayat. And it was as if these ayat were just revealed. They heard it for the first time. And then they realized what had happened. They came to the realization that the Prophet alayhi salam had passed away. The greatest calamity to happen is Ummah. Muhammad alayhi salatu salam has faced it. And his death, it is from the minor signs of Yawm al-Qiyamah. Just like his prophethood is from the signs of the Day of Judgment, just like that, his death is one of the minor signs of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he tells in the Quran, فَهَلْ يَنظُرُونَ إِلَّا السَّاعَةَ أَن تَأْتِيَهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَقَدْ جَاءَ أَشْرَاطُهَا فَأَنَّى لَهُمْ إِذَا جَاءَتْهُمْ ذِكْرَاهُمْ. Allah says, فَهَلْ يَنظُرُونَ, are they waiting? إِلَّا السَّاعَةَ أَن تَأْتِيَهُمْ بَغْتَةً, are they waiting for the hour to come suddenly? فَقَدْ جَاءَ أَشْرَاطُهَا, the signs of the hour have come to them. Yani these signs are to, for us to wake up, to come out of our heedlessness. Imagine, that's the death of the Prophet ﷺ, which happened so long ago, right? It's a sign of the hour that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants us to know that we need to prepare. And he alayhi salatu salam, he said that bu'ithtu ana was-sa'a kahatayn. He says, me and the hour, we were set like these two fingers. And he places two fingers together like that. That's how close he said the hour is. He's saying that so long ago. Imagine now. That the majority of the minor signs of the hour have been seen already. It should be a wake-up call for us to realize that we are getting closer and closer and closer to the end. And on top of that, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he tells us that it is not only these signs that should wake us up, but also there are other signs that happen to us that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala sends us signs and warnings to us. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says that it will be said to the disbelievers who are in the hellfire,
أولم نعمركم ما يتذكر فيه من تذكر وجاءكم النذير فذوقوا فما للظالمين من نصير.
Allah says, it will be said to them, those who are in the punishment in hellfire, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ, have we not allowed you to live? As long as one can remember. وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ, and the warner came to you. The warner here is the messengers, the signs came to you. And then some of the fasirun, they say, old age, grey hair came to you. Grey hair is a warner telling you that you're getting closer, wake up, prepare. فَذُوقُوا, be said to them then, فَذُوقُوا, taste it. Endure that punishment. And the transgressors will not have any aiders or helpers in that punishment. That is what Allah tells in the Quran. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was telling the Sahaba رضي الله عنه, when one of us dies and he enters his grave and he sees his grave either become a garden from the gardens of paradise or a pit from the pits of the hellfire. And every single one of us, when he enters his grave, he is going to be squeezed by his grave. Everyone. Amongst us are those who, or the disbelievers, when he squeezes them, he's going to squeeze them to the extent that their ribs are going to cross each other. So tight. And for the believer, is going to squeeze him, but it will be like a hug. When someone hugs you, you'll not feel any pain. And then it will release itself for the believer and become vast and spacious, but it will remain tight for the disbeliever. One may ask, if every single one of us knows where he's heading towards in the hereafter, in his grave, why is it that Yawm al-Qiyamah everyone's terrified? Why is everyone scared? If they only were told that they're going to be heading to that destination which they're shown through a window, why are people so terrified? Because Yawm al-Qiyamah, the situation is so terrifying that everyone forgets everything prior to that. They're so scared that they can't remember what they were told prior to that. Terrifying. They're running around scared. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, يُحْشَرُ النَّاسِ يوم القيامة, the people are going to be resurrected on the day of judgment. حفاء, عراء, غرلا, they're going to be barefoot, naked, uncircumcised. And then Aisha رضي الله عنها, she said, يا رسول الله, أيبصر بعضنا بعضا, are we going to be looking at each other? And then he said to her عليه الصلاة والسلام, يا عائشة الأمر أشد, that the situation is going to be worse than that. It's going to be too severe for anyone to have any moment to think about anything else or look at anything else. And then he, in the one riwayah, he recited the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه. The day, that day, that individual is going to flee from his brother, his mother, his father, his wife, his children, the closest people to him in the dunya, he's going to flee from them. Because لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه, every single one of them, every single individual that day, he's going to have his own affairs that concern him, that he's preoccupied by. He doesn't have time to help anyone else. Rather, they will be harmful to one another. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, فَإِذَا نُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَلَا أَنْسَابَ بَيْنَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَلَا يَتَسَاءَلُونَ. Allah says, when the horn is blown, the second blowing of the horn, and then when everyone's resurrected, there will be no family ties between them. يوم القيامة there's no such thing as family. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu commenting on these ayah, he says يوم القيامة when the people are resurrected, every single individual is going to look for anyone who wronged him in any way in order to get good deeds and collect good deeds to save himself. And he's going to start with his mother and father and his closest relatives. He's going to start from them to get collect good deeds from them. And then he recited the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, فَإِذَا نُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَلَا أَنْسَابَ بَيْنَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَلَا يَتَسَاءَلُونَ. When the horn is blown, there's no family ties. You are not only going to be one who doesn't help his family, but you might be one who harms them يوم القيامة. You try to get good deeds from them by trying to save yourself. This is the day that the prophets and the messengers, they're going to say, nafsi, nafsi, myself, myself. Everyone's concerned about themselves. Every single individual is going to be preoccupied with his own situation. But before people even get there, and they get to that situation that they're so terrified, after the people, they spend years and years and years in their grave. And then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will allow them to be resurrected. They come out of their graves. مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. Allah says, from it we created you, i.e. the earth. And we're going to return you back into it, i.e. the earth. And we're going to take you out from it, i.e. resurrected from the earth. Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to resurrect all the creation. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, لا أقسم بيوم القيامة ولا أقسم بالنفس اللوامة أيحسب الإنسان أن نجمع عظامه بلى قادرين على أن نسوي بنانا. Allah says that, does this man think that we're not going to gather his bones and bring it together again? Because the mushrikeen of Quraysh used to deny that, are they going to be resurrected? Allah says, بلى قادرين, rather we are بلى قادرين على أن نسوي بنانا, we're going to bring back his fingerprints. Right? The fingerprint of every individual is very unique, it's different. Right? Allah says, we're going to bring that back. Forget anything else. We're going to bring that back exactly the way it was. Every single one has been resurrected. Allah Azza wa Jalla will tell the earth to bring out everything inside it. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَثْقَالَهَا وقال الإنسان ما لها يومئذ تحدث أخبارها. Allah says, إذا زلزلت الأرض زلزالها, when the earth is going to shake, shaking, وأخرجت الأرض أثقالها, and the earth is going to throw out أثقالها, all that which is heavy and down, يعني everything else inside it, it's going to come out. The disbelievers and the criminals, they're going to be resurrected blue. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah Taha, وَنَحْشُرُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ يَوْمَئِذٍ زُرْقًا, that the mujrimeen and the criminals, يوم, that day, they're going to be resurrected blue. They're going to have blue signs on them. And then they are going to be questioned, how long were you there previously? Okay, Allah Azza wa Jalla goes on to say, يَتَخَافَتُونَ بَيْنَهُمْ إِن لَبِثْتُمْ إِلَّا عَشْرًا نَحْنُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ إِذْ يَقُولُ أَمْثَلُهُمْ طَرِيقَةً إِن لَبِثْتُمْ إِلَّا يَوْمًا ويسألونك عن الجبال فقل ينسفها ربي نسفا فيذرها قاعا صفصفا لا ترى فيها عوجا ولا أمتا. الله عز وجل says, يتخافتون بينهم إن لبثتم illa ashra, that they say that you remained for 10 days. Then nahnu, Allah says, nahnu a'lamu bima yaqulun. We are the most knowing of what they say. إِذْ يَقُولُ أَمْثَلُهُمْ طَرِيقَةً إِنْ لَبِثْتُمْ إِلَّا يَوْمًا. The one that's the best of them, they will say, إِنْ لَبِثْتُمْ إِلَّا يَوْمًا, that you only remain for a day. Right? And then Allah said, they ask about the mountains. What is going to happen to the mountains? Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala says, فَقُلْ يَنْسِفْهَا رَبِّي نَسْفًا. The mountains, they're going to be leveled. They are going to look like a mirage. All those huge mountains that we saw in this world, Allah Tabarak was going to level them. And that's why the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he told us that whoever amongst you wants to see يوم القيامة رأي العين, as if he can see it, then let him recite Surah Al-Takwir and Surah Al-Infitar and Surah Al-Inshiqaq. Because Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala, he describes what is going to happen at the end of the world, and Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala, he tells us what's going to happen يوم القيامة in detail, as if you can see it. So the Prophet ﷺ told us to read these surahs. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said, شَيَّبَتْنِي هُود وَأَخَوَاتُهَا, that surah Hud and his sisters, they caused me to have grey hairs. Why? Because these surahs, they talk about يوم القيامة. Amongst the other surahs that the Prophet ﷺ was referring to is عَمَّ يَتَسَأَلُونَ, surah Naba, and surah التَّكْوِير and Infitar and so on, and Surah Al-Waqi'ah, etc. They talk about يوم القيامة. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوْمِرَتْ. Allah says, when the sun كُوْمِرَتْ, it will be burnt out, the light of the sun, all gone. وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ طَمَسَتْ, وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ طَمَسَتْ, Surah Al-Takwir, was it? كدرت, نعم كدرت, and the stars, they are going to be كدرت, i.e. they're going to fall dead. That's يوم القيامة, the end of times. Allah says in Surah Al-Infitar, إذا السماء انفطرت, when the سماء, the sky, انفطرت, it will split. In Surah Al-Inshiqaq, إذا السماء انشقت, when the sky was split. All of this is happening on al qiyamah, when the world is ending. Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala causes all that to happen for the people to see all that will happen, and it will be something that's devastating. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he calls yawm al qiyamah, فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبَرَى يَوْمَ يَتَذَكَّرُ الْإِنسَانُ مَا سَعَى وَبُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِمَنْ يَرَى فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى وآثر الحياة الدنيا فإن الجحيم هي المأوى وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى. الله عز وجل, فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى, when the greatest calamity, the great calamity will come, يوم القيامة. ورد الله تبارك وتعالى call it الطامة, that great calamity. Allah tells you after, in the ayah that comes after, يوم يتذكر الإنسان ما سعى, it's that day that the human being is going to remember everything that he strived to do in this world, whether it was good or bad. He's going to remember it immediately, and he's going to either regret it and feel a lot of regret and remorse, or he's going to be one who rejoices. And then Allah says, وَبُرِّزَتِ الْجَحِيمُ لِمَنْ يَرَى, and the hellfire is going to be apparent for those who see. It will be made clear for everyone to see. Then Allah says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ طَغَى, as for the one who transgressed. وَآثَرَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, as for the one who transgressed, i.e. disbelieved. He disobeyed Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala, and he preferred the life of this dunya. He gave preference to the life of this dunya over the life of the hereafter. وآثر الحياة الدنيا فإن الجحيم هي المأوى. Jahim is going to be his abode. الله سبحانه من خاف مقام ربي. As for the one who fears مقام ربه, the ulama and the fasirun, they mention that this means a number of things. Number one, it means he fears the greatness of his Lord, and they also say it means that he fears the standing before his Lord, يوم القيامة. And as for the one who fears the standing before his Lord, and fears his Lord, the greatness of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, he has that khawf, that fear. And due to that fear that he has, وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى, he prevents his soul from following desires. What are those desires? The evil desires that Allah has prohibited. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Jannah is going to be his abode, his home. That is the طَامَة. That's devastation that's going to happen. That Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. يا أيها الناس, الله سبحانه وتعالى kind. Fear your Lord. إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم. Verily the shaking of the hour, it is a great matter. يوم ترونها, that day you're going to see. تذهل كل مرضعة, you're going to see every breastfeeding mother drop her child. And every pregnant woman is going to have a miscarriage. And the people, they are intoxicated. They look intoxicated, but they are not intoxicated. Why are they acting like that? Because of the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's day that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is telling us about in the Quran, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam describing in his Sunnah. They are being described in that fashion so that the individual, he does whatever he can to be those who are safe, so that he does not end up being amongst those who it will be said, فَإِنَّ الْجَحِيمَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Jahim is his abode. So we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who are saved on that day. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who are protected from his punishment. And we ask Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala to make us from those who it said about, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ سَبَقَتْ لَهُمْ مِنَّ الْحُسْنَى أُولَٰئِكَ عَنْهَا مُبْعَدُونَ. Those who Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased with, they will be distanced from that fire. They will not hear it, they won't come close to them. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive our sins. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to guide us and decrease us and guide us and to guide others to us. إِنَّهُ جُوَادٌ كَرِيمٌ وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمُ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيِّ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. بارك الله.